Do you like fighting games, but kind of suck at them? Do you like card games, but don't like pay-to-win elements? Would you like a game that combines the best of both? There's no need to answer. I can read your every thought. First released in 2011 by Sirlin Games, the brainchild of David Sirlin. The very same David Sirlin who authored Playing to Win, helped Capcom in balancing Super Street Fighter II Turbo HD Remix, and is a frequent contributor to the gaming website Gamma Sutra. Though you may or may not agree with his theories or opinions on competitive gaming, there is no question that the man knows a thing or two about game design and balance. Yomi was designed to capture the mind games that could be found in high-level play in fighting game tournaments, without the manual dexterity required to be the next Daigo.
For it! He's going for it! Will he get the jump afterward? Here it is!
Oh. It is an asymmetrical card game with very exposed fighting game roots. Not surprisingly, because David Sirlin originally approached Capcom about using the Street Fighter characters when he first thought of the concept. Capcom was hesitant and eventually rejected the idea. So David Sirlin instead created his own original characters and the Fantasy Strike universe. In Yomi, each player is tied to the same rule set, but much like a fighting game, each character plays very differently and has different effective strategies. There is a character to suit every playstyle. You have the agile but weak Valerie who can wear down her opponents through impressive combos. You have the solid Rook who can attack even after being hit, much like Super Armor. The luck-based panda Lum, and the healer Gloria. You have quite literal control decks like Persephone, aggressive decks like Onimaru, or defensive decks like Truck. And finally, you have the Ken and Ryu of the game, Grave and Janus Stormborn. Each character has a 54-card deck with a mixture of attacks, throws, blocks, dodges, and special moves. It plays very similar to Rock, Paper, Scissors. Blocks and dodges will beat attacks, throws will beat blocks and dodges, and attacks will beat throws. It seems very simple, but it goes much more in depth. Each attack and throw has priority, indicated by how quick it is, so it's rare to come up instances of a draw. Attacks can combo with starters, linkers, and enders, leading to big damage with the right cards. Throws can leave your opponent in a mix-up state. You can charge up by discarding pairs to gain aces, which are often your most powerful move. And jokers can act like combo breakers. But if you don't have one, well, your opponent doesn't need to know that. But the real strategy behind Yomi is reading your opponent. Having the most devastating combo means nothing if you can't reliably land it. You have to consider what your opponent is going to do and how you are going to act or react. For example, your opponent just traded four of a kind to put three aces into his hand, which allows him to use his super move. If he lands it with your current amount of health, he wins the game. You have the option to block or dodge, which would be the best option if he uses it immediately, but maybe that's too obvious. Maybe that's what he wants you to do, and he's going to lay down a throw so he can combo you into a super. So maybe your best option is to use the quickest attack you have, knowing it can beat his aces or any of his throws. But what if he decides to play defensively? You only have one shot at the strategy, and if he blocks it, it's gone. Or worse, he decides to dodge it and counters with a super, losing the game anyway. You can always throw, but if he was indeed so bold to use his super, it may seem like a coin flip, with every option being equals in terms of success or failure. But it doesn't have to be that black and white. You can judge and gauge your opponent and think about what he would do in this situation. Has he been playing aggressively or more defensively? Does he take the risky strategy? Or does he prefer to use his super when he can guarantee it hitting? Does he play more defensively when he has less than 5 cards in his hand? does he seem to focus too much on what you're going to do? These are the same mind games that can occur from a very tense situation in a fighting game. And Yomi captures that brilliantly at a pace that can be appreciated by those who can't tell the fifth frame of animation in Sagat's crouching fears from the sixth. Yomi does a lot with very little. It's easy to forget that the game is based on a standard playing deck of cards. Yet the game has been so finely tuned that no matter the matchup, no matter the hands, no matter your opponent, you always feel in control of your destiny, which is exceptionally rare to feel in any card game. The fact that the game completely avoids any pay-to-win elements is nice as well. And thanks to a fairly strong community, it's easy to learn how to play each character and the strategies involved. I highly recommend Yomi to anyone who is even slightly interested in game design, fighting games, or card games. However, it comes with a few caveats I feel I should mention. The first one is the price. For $15 on Steam, it seems like a fair value. However, it only contains 10 of the 20 characters available. The other 10 characters are an additional $15, and $30 for the complete game can seem really expensive if you're a budget gamer like me. There are microtransactions for the digital game as well, giving you random cards that keep track of stats, such as how many times you hit or missed with that card. Meanwhile, the physical version costs upwards of $200 if you want the complete set. I can verify that the physical version is great quality, but it's really hard to justify unless you're already fans of the game. Secondly, the digital version of the game has bot support, which is nice, but it carries with it a flaw. Since the game is primarily about reading your opponent, the artificial intelligence has a distinct advantage over you. It doesn't seem advanced enough to emulate a human's playstyle. The easier difficulty seems to just pick cards at random, while the more difficult opponent seems to play just on calculated risk. Both are not nearly as satisfying as playing a human opponent. And as a more personal gripe, it's a shame that there isn't more world building or character development in the game. You strictly get the gameplay with very little knowledge of the characters, their backstories, their relationships to other characters, or the world that they're living in. And it's a shame because from the looks of it, Mr. Sirlin put a decent effort into the character design and the Fantasy Strike world. Yeah, I know fighting game stories are laughable and just the fat on the real meat, but some sort of story mode would have been a welcome option and would have really driven the point that this is a fighting game in card form. For those of you who want to get straight into the action, know this game was designed for you. It's all crunch and no fluff. If any of this enticed you, you can try the game out on fantasystrike.com/game. And you can also play two other games based in the Fantasy Strike universe, Flash Duel and Puzzle Strike. And if that made you a fan, know that David Sirlin is planning on making an actual fighting game and has some very interesting ideas on how he's going to do that. You can find out more on that on Sirlin.net. Meanwhile, this is SoberDwarf reminding you that gaining experience builds character. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next speedrun.